Right then, folks, you join me here today at the beautiful Aston Park Fisheries, where we're going to be taking our pole fishing to the next level. So think back to sort of last year when I did the beginner's guide to the margin pole when we used the Edge Monster. Brilliant pole, obviously, for its purpose, absolutely amazing. But when you come to venues such as this one here, we're on Bill's Lake at Aston Park, when you've got an island that little bit further away, you do need to get to it. Pretty much all seasons, that's where we want to be starting off our fishing. So 13 metre pole is probably going to be your next step up. You don't need to spend a lot of money, folks. It's just getting a good quality 13 metre pole. Our Superium X10 is awesome for this. It comes with three top kits. You get a match kit, two carp kits, and you get a cupping kit as well. And even a little babby extension, which takes it to its true length of 13 metres. Obviously, canal-like, snake-like fishing is probably the most popular way of fishing, you know. So many fish are in that cover, especially if it ever blooming does warm up, folks. You know, the carp love to hide under that cover. Certainly at the start of the session, you know, look at the path here. It's full of stones and gravel. It's naturally pushing the fish across. So it's an area of your swim where you do need to target, I'm going to say first, before you sort of like come back down the middle and down the edges. So that's why you do need a slightly longer pole. Cheeky. There's a few different aspects into how we're going to ship the pole out. You definitely need another roller as well. Remember last time we had one roller, you do need two rollers when you're going anything past, I'm going to say sort of 9 meters. So first things first, we need to make sure they're set up right, and then it's a case of making sure you're nice and comfortable with the pole. There's nothing complicated, as you saw in the last video, nothing complicated with what we're going to do with shipping the pole out. It's just making sure you're doing it right, getting the balance spots right on the pole for your roller, so that you're keeping the bait in your pole pot when we're shipping across. We can tap it in and catch loads of fishes. So I think that's the next thing that I'm going to show you. We're going to go through pole roller placement, why you need two, why you need a double one at the front, a single one at the back, and how your back one needs to be slightly higher than your front one. But I'll waffle all about that in a bit, folks, when we go over to the pole rollers. So let's go and have a look. Okay then, so first things first, you've got your brand new shiny 30 metre pole. You must look after it, folks. Especially conditions like this, you know, where the stones and chippings down, you need to make sure it's being looked after. First things first, you need a pole sock. Got to get a pole sock. Lots of different ones out on the market. I like to have my pole sock. You'll see here when Zolt's going to zoom in, I've got a ripple bar, extending ripple bar. Because this bit here, folks, this is where I'm going to be shipping my pole, in this gap here. So I don't want anything this side of my pole sock that potentially is going to get in the way of me shipping the pole in. We don't want that. So that's first thing. The next thing you'll see, I've got this pole up to 13 metres, cheeky, at the minute, but I've split it down twice so I can show you exactly where you need to position your first roller. So if you follow me, you need to get, this is so important, folks, and I'll explain why when we get into that back roller, you need to make sure you're getting a double pole roller. Reason for that is when you're splitting your pole down twice, if you imagine you've just got a single pole roller, when you're splitting that down, they're both going to, you know, whack against themselves. So when you go to ship in, you're going to be taking the rest of the pole with you. And obviously your pole might go for a swim in the lake, and we don't want that. So that's why you need this bit here. Keeps them completely separate, and it just obviously protects your pole so that that's completely separate to this bit here. So that's the first thing. Next thing is, where do I put the first pole roller? Right, is it? It's a foolproof guide that I use, folks. Bearing in mind, on all these venues, whether it be Snake Lake like today or an open water, I've always got a short swim. So whether that's my top kit and then two sections or three sections on, I'll always fish with three sections, and I'll either use that joint as a marker on my box, this joint here on my 4 and 5 section, or I'll come right to the end and use my number 5 section on my elbow or leg on my box. We can go through that later on. But basically, as a rule, so take your top kit away. When you've got your three sections set up, your fifth section or your third section, depending on obviously what pole you get, wants to be roughly halfway over. Yeah, so there's the joint and there's the end of the pole. It wants to be roughly halfway over that first roller. And then obviously your next three sections, your 13 meter, they go on the other side. Now, to get the correct distance for your back roller, which needs to be a single one, we'll go through that in a sec. What we do, we come to the end of the section here. You put that right in the middle of the pole roller. and then you look behind you, and then you want to be roughly a foot down from the joint. So if you follow me, so I'm going to keep that there. Follow me. So yeah, from this joint here, roughly around a foot to 14 inches away. And that will be perfect balance. When we put this pole together in a sec, you'll get perfect balance. Now, let me just put this one back in the socks, Alt, and let me explain why this one here, I'm going to kneel down for this one. This is why we need a flat roller for the back. We don't want a double roller. Simply because when we're shipping the pole back, I'm coming this side of the double roller, and I just want to ship back in one. I want one quick look behind me, get my pole on the roller, and then ship back nice and smooth so I can keep an eye on what that fish is doing. So if I was to have like a double bit there, chances are you're going to be walloping it. Obviously, if your rollers are set up right, don't let it bother you, but it's far better that you have a single pole roller, such as this one. The other thing as well, you probably can't notice from here, to be fair, but my back roller is slightly higher than my front roller. Now, that's important for a couple of reasons. First one, when you're shipping out, you want to make sure your rig's nice and low on the water. I mean, obviously, little babby rigs, shallow rigs aside, because they're prone to tangling. So you want to make sure your rig's in the water all the time, so you're shipping out nice and smooth. We'll go through how we ship the pole out after this. Basically, putting slight downward pressure on the pole, but I'll talk you through that. Yeah, so your front roller slightly lower than your back one. So that the other reason as well is when you're shipping back, you're not putting loads of stress on that fish. You know, you don't want your pole roller, you know, really high or anything like that, putting loads of stress on that fish. And also, because these are like super, super rolly, these ones, if your front one was higher than your back one, your pole's been going bye-bye into the lake or into the field behind you, and we don't want that. So, I know I'm waffling, but make sure your back roller is slightly higher than your front one. Right, let's go back down there again then, Zolt. So, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put the pole together, and then I'm going to talk you through step by step how we ship the pole out when we're fishing at distance. So I'm going to come back onto that roller, so you can see nice and smooth, and it just fits in there. If your back roller is unbalanced, what's going to happen is you're going to see your pole sort of like obviously start to tilt, because you've got too much weight at the back, which means the pivot point on that back roller, technical for me this, isn't it, folks? But basically the pivot point on that back roller is too close to your first roller, so just move it a little bit further away, and then what you should get, it should be nice and balanced. You see, if it's nice and balanced, everything will be fine. It's not going to roll away from you or anything like that. Right, so that's the pole together at 13 meters. What I want to talk you through now is shipping out with a pole. Now, if you've not done it before, it will take a bit of practice, and that's all it is. So what I'd recommend is, without a rig on or anything like that, folks, just put your top kit on and just practice shipping out. What you don't want, in fact, I'm going to get you to zoom in a bit, Zolt, on that back roller to show you the right way and the wrong way. So the correct way, I'm not going to show you the wrong way first, I'll get my top kit on first, actually, so I can show you. Top kit goes on. Because my pole rollers are right, I don't need to look behind me. What I want to do is keep an eye on what's going on in front of me, yeah? I want to make sure my bait's staying in my pot and my rig is low to the water, so I'm not tangling. First thing I want to do is put ever so slight downward pressure on that pole, because I don't want it flopping. So you can, I don't want it flopping off that back roller. So slight downward pressure on that pole, and then as I ship out, there'll be no bounce off that back roller. You see, once you get to your balance point, so I've not come off this first roller yet, what you'll find, you'll come to your balance point where the pole, ever so slightly now, is starting to tip over. So what you want to do in that scenario is ship the pole over your legs, and then it's just a case of taking your time, using both arms. Don't just keep one fixed and then use the back arm, or vice versa, use this arm and keep that one fixed. You want to use them both at the same time. So as I'm pulling out with my left arm, I'm coming back with my right arm. Yeah? So it's sort of like alternate, if you like. So you see, there's no commotion, no bouncing or anything like that. Everything's nice and smooth. And then what I'm doing, I'm feeling for the end of the pole, which is there. So what I'll do, I'll put my arm flat on the pole. And then if I'm fishing on the back of that joint, what I'll do, I'll just keep shipping out little bits at a time, just until that pole is under my elbow. Now, when you're sat right, so that the most important thing is sitting right on your box. Now, you won't know this until you get fishing with a longer pole when you're fishing at distance. When you're fishing with a short pole, you might just have it over one knee. Obviously, in the video, I taught you about having it over two knees. So if you followed that guide, this will be far easier for you. Now what we want to do is have the arm flat on a pole, tuck that pole into our body. If it's very windy, use your arm to support the pole, so have that right the way down the pole. If it's not, just nice and comfy. You know what I mean? Just tuck that pole into your body, just have it nice and comfy. But what you must have, folks, is your feet flat on your foot plate. Obviously, we talked through this before in the Edge Monster video, the margin video that we did, margin pole video. Don't have your feet at an angle, so you're on your tippy toes, if you like. Your feet must be flat on your foot plate. That's only through trial and error, making sure that your box is the correct height for you. Right, so pretend we've got a fish on. First thing we do, we strike into the fish, we ship back nice and quick, and then it's a quick look round, make sure we're on that first roller. And then we need to make sure we're keeping an eye on what's going on in front of us with that fish. So what I want to do is make sure that pole's low to the water, and then it's another look behind you. Not on that second roller yet, just another look behind you. Once you're on that second roller, the flat one, you know you can just ship back and it won't be a problem. You've not got like the middle bit to clatter into, anything like that. Then it's just a case of just being nice and smooth, putting the pole back into the pole sock or pole retainer, and that's it, folks. There's nothing complicated with it. But what I want to show you, if Zolt goes to the end, you don't mind Zolt, I want to show you the right way and the wrong way to the end, shipping out. He's on it. So when you're shipping out, folks, the wrong way, if you didn't put slight downward pressure on that pole, you watch what happens to the back of that pole. Doink. So it flops off that back roller. I'll just show you again. Are you on it, Zolt? He's on it. Of course he is. Working with professionals, yeah? So when we're shipping out, if you don't put slight downward pressure, what happens if it flops off that back roller like that, and you've got bait in your pot, your bait's going everywhere. So the correct way is, obviously, remember, I won't be looking behind me. I'll be keeping an eye on what's going on in front of me, but I'm going to demonstrate for you. If I put ever so slight downward pressure on that pole, you watch what happens with the back of that pole. So it just comes off the roller nice and smooth, so you're not bouncing that bait out or anything like that, and that's what we want, yeah? So again, nice slight downward pressure, and exactly the same on this one here. As soon as you start to feel that pole start to tip over, you're pulling it over your knees and then just shipping out nice and smooth. There's no rush or anything like that. Obviously, if you've not done this style of fishing before, just take your time with it, get out there and practice, folks. What's not better than to go out and practice fishing? It is the best thing in the whole wide world. So I think that's it for now. That's roller placement. So remember, you need a double roller for the front, single roller for the back. Make sure you have a pole sock. Make sure that your third section, so whether it's your fifth or your sixth section, depending on obviously what pole you go for, is halfway over your first roller. And then it's the same distance to the back one, leaving about 12 inches to 14 inches from that section to the joint of the section. And then you won't have any trouble whatsoever. The only thing to bear in mind is, obviously, if you go for like a 14.5 meter pole, for example, you know, it might come with an extension, then just move the sections back around, I'm going to say 12 inch intervals or something like that. So both of them will need to be moved back 12 inch intervals just to support the weight and obviously making sure that the pole is not under any undue stress or anything like that. So that's the roller setup. I think we'll go through rigs next. Right, we're nearly ready to get fishing, folks, and I can't wait. There's blooming carp everywhere, all over the peg, so literally can't wait to get fishing. But before we do, talk about the package. So with the Superium X10 that we're using today, I briefly touched upon it before, you get a match kit inside the pole, which is reinforced, which is the beauty of this. Obviously, for match kits, I'd 100% recommend using puller kits. They're so good, folks, honestly. And that's why we give you the option of wrapping this. So definitely get it with a side puller. And then through the match kit, I'd probably put something like, I'm going to say like a 7-inch Dura, which will do you for pretty much everything swimming. Obviously, if it's not great big wobbly things, but all your sort of silvers, you know, if you want a day target in silvers, coming into the winter, it'll do for, again, your silvers, but your carp and your F1s as well. So in the match kit that you get with a pole, definitely something along the 7s, something like that. And then you also get two carp kits with a pole, plus your cupping kit as well. And a little Babby Half extension as well, which is like a rounders bat, a good one, Zolt. So you get this as well. Now, the beauty of these half extensions, which most poles will do, is that they're completely reinforced. So there's like, this is where all the extra carbon's gone into the pole, folks. And I tend to use them a lot for using as me with my elbow on. so I don't damage the pole or anything like that, or I use that joint if needs be. We don't need to today, and I'll talk you through why. But basically, I've got the 30 meter pole section on that. I'll be lining it up with a leg, like my middle leg, cheeky, something like that, just so I know I'm going back to the same spot every time. But very, very handy in using these. So whenever you're fishing past 13 meters, I pretty much always use them, because I say it just sort of like helps your pole, and you know, so your elbow's not going through anything like that. It makes sure that you're keeping your pole nice and safe. So that's the half extension. Come back to the other two carp kits now then, and I'd go for, so take this lake for example. There's lots of F1s in, lots of carp, a few silvers as well. Early spring, I'd probably go something like what we're using today, which is our green DuraSlip hybrid. Perfect elastic, you know, lovely for cushioning the carp and the F1s. But the main thing is, folks, with these carp kits, they do come pre-bush, so it doesn't really matter how big the carp or the fish you've got on the end of the pole. Once you get it back to your top kit, which hopefully we'll demonstrate later on, you're just using this puller kit to like increase the pressure at that end. It's almost like a reel. So that's why I don't really advocate using really heavy elastics. You know, obviously, if you're going to venues that are full of snags, then that's when you might need to step up. But as a guide, I'd probably go for like an 11s, and then in your other kit, a 13s or a 15s, you know. Just something that will, cushion them big carp lunges, something like that. But obviously, if you're fishing venues where it is grab big wobbly things, then just stick like 15s and a 17 or a 15 and a 19, something like that. Just something that will cover absolutely everything. Right, so that's the top kits covered. What I want to get onto is the rigs and where we're fishing today. So our first swim, I'm going to be fishing right across. Remember me saying at the start when we first talked about, you know, the banking behind you and like the commotion. Imagine, obviously, myself from a match perspective, people walking around, you know, trudging on the stones and that, the vibrations. For me, it naturally pushes the fish across to the far bank. Hence the reason why you do need a longer pole when you're fishing these kind of venues. So that's where I want to start off first. So what I've done, I've got the end of my pole lined up with the back of my leg. My elbow's not right on the end, so I don't need this half extension. To be fair, I wasn't sure it was this shallow. You know, it's proper shallow across there, which is perfect for like the heights of summer, but I want to find an area where the fish feel comfortable in. And at the minute, 2 foot's been an amazing depth. Wherever I've been the last few weeks, folks, on all these different venues, 2 foot has been the, you know, the best place to catch the fish to start with across. So as I say, I'll show you in a bit when we're shipping across. I've got the back of my pole lined up with this leg, and then I've got a marker. There's some like, I'll zoom round in a minute. There's some like yellow buttercuppy flowers. They look like buttercups, folks, but I don't think they are. But what I'm doing, I'm lining up with the end of like them yellowy buttercuppy flowers over there, and that's my marker for across there. And then the next thing, dead simple, I've literally put this to 2 foot. But we'll come on to that in a sec. First things first, I've got the 11s Dura on. I've got a little babby pot on the end because with it being carp and F1s, folks, I want to target them. I've got maggots with me, but I don't really want to go down that route. I want to just want a lovely day's fishing, hopefully catching carp and F1s. So I want to be sort of selective. Now, I say selective, but bear in mind, obviously, these fish, you know, from when they're like little babby things like this, little fry, all they see is sort of fish meal products and pellets. So pellets will pretty much catch it absolutely everything swimming. So with hard pellets, being a little bit more selective, you do need a little babby pot. Main line on all my rigs this time of year is 0.18 AccuPower, all my main lines, for pretty much everything. I won't really go less than sort of 0.11 diameter. I won't really go less than that now, until we're coming into, you know, obviously colder weather towards the end of the year, or if I was targeting silvers, then I might drop a little bit lighter, but 0.11 will do you pretty much everything on these kind of venues. You can always go heavier, which is why I put a thicker main line on. So if I wanted, you know, if I was catching grapping wobbly things, big carps like, yeah, I could go to like a 0.15 or a 0.16. And obviously, if you do get a grap big one that's going to wobble off up the canal, it's only going to break your hook length, so you can just put another one on. Nice and simple. It's very important you're using a heavier main line than what your hook length breaks at. So, 0.18 main line. I've got a little bit of line there between pole tip and float. My old favourite back shots, which is 2 number 8 stots on there, folks. Obviously, tip X'd out white so we can see them. You know, I get the mick taken out of me all the time. What sort of bit of fluff on your line, Andy? It's not fluff, folks. It's stocked with a little bit of Tippex on. Now, obviously, that'll become apparent why I use them across there later on because of the colour of the water. Now, float-wise, massive fan of these F1 pellet or F1 maggot floats, folks. I think they're superb, you know, nice and durable, nice and stable. Certainly these with a flexi wire stem, lovely floats. Bristle-wise, I won't worry too much about that. 1.5 to 2 mil will be absolutely bang on. I have got a tiny little bit of bristle grease on the tip there, just so it sits at like sort of 3 or 4 mil above the water. Because F1s, folks, the blooming nightmare to like see the bikes and that little shaky dips on your float. So you've got to make sure that you're sitting your float low, otherwise you just won't see them. Now, coming down the line, so I've got a single number 11 stock just under my float there, just to bring that float down a little bit more. And then I've got a series of, we've got 5 number 10 shots on this rig. Nice and simple, just spread through, because although I'll be cupping the pellets in to make the noise and just get them in a little babby area so the fish know exactly where they're coming to, where my hook bait is, I want the option of catapulting as well. I wouldn't necessarily use this if I was going in shallow water, this float. That's when I come on to like the more dumpy floats. But for this, and possibly a little bit deeper, these floats are absolutely perfect for it. You know, we bang on about them all the time. And then coming on to the hook length, straight out of the packet job, folks. You know how I work. So basically, let me just put that down. I'll either be on, we've got the 16s GPMBs or the 18s GPMBs, 0.11 and 0.13. Starting off on a 0.11, just to see what's what. If we're getting some great big wobbly things or we get snapped, then I'm just going to step up to a 16s 0.13, just to give me that, you know, that little bit of reassurance that when it hooks something big, we're not going to get snapped. But always, as a tip, folks, always start off a little bit lighter. You can always go sort of heavier, but the first sort of like, first part of your match or your session, if you like, that's the important one. You know, you want to make sure you're putting a few fish on the bank, get your confidence up, and then you can go from there. So always start off a bit lighter. Incidentally, shot-wise, so obviously we'll come back to the shots and you'll see how I've got these spaced out, spaced through the rig, not in a bulk or anything like that. Now, it's important when you want your shotting like that, that you are using a good quality shot. So I've got 10s on for this rig. My next rig, I've got 9s on. So good quality, soft lead shot, perfect. For me, I'd sooner use shot than stots, because stots, brilliant for putting on your line with the big splits and that, but they do tend to move, and I don't want to be moving them, obviously, through the course of a session. I want to make sure my shots are staying there. So get yourself some of them, folks, to bang on. So that's the fishing across. Now, obviously, I'm going to be looking for signs, liners, foul lookers. If I'm getting lots of them, then obviously I'll change my feeding. We can talk through that. But also, I might want to find a little bit shallower water. So I'll knock like 6-8 inches off my float, find shallower water where the fish feel a bit more confident or comfortable, if you like. And then the other swim, so I'm keeping it nice and simple today, folks, is exactly the same mainline, exactly the same elastic, got our back shots on there, exactly the same float, but just a size heavier because it's a little bit deeper water. So we've got a 412s F1 pellet on in this case. And we've that one set at 2 foot, and literally all I've done, put a plummet on, gone and found it. And we're roughly sitting to the bottom of the body on that because we're on a little bit of a slope. This one is literally straight down the middle. Remember me saying I'm fishing a top kit with the three sections on. I'm using the joint on my 4 and 5 section, lining up with this leg here, and I'm fishing opposite a tree right in front of me. I've got fish blowing down there already, folks, so that's giving me confidence. I know there's some fish there. So I'm fishing on that joint, so now I'm going back to the same spot every time, and it's roughly, probably about 3.5 foot. Yeah, 3.5 foot, something like that. Incidentally, the other thing on our top kits, folks, you have got the depth markers on. You know, you'll hear about it all the time when you're looking at results in papers, or you know, you're just having a glance, people say, well, I've caught at 2 foot today. So the beauty of our top kits, you put your rig to 2 foot and go and find it. I know, obviously, fishing in the deeper water, you're going to catch everything swimming down there, so whatever the depth it is down there, we can go and find it. You know what I mean? So that's why we put on slightly heavier float, and then this time similar shot in, but in the bottom third, and we've got number 9s on. Just for that extra bit of positivity, you know, when a fish comes into your peg, you're seeing that bite as soon as it happens. Exactly the same hook length, 0.11, GPMB, 18s, no different whatsoever. Now, bait-wise, now it's fishery on pellets here, and the quality pellets, to be fair, folks, the Coppins pellets. It's Aston Park, fishery on pellets. What I like to do is a little bit of a boost is going to give our salty caramel absolute liquid flavour a plug. Honestly, folks, if you don't drink it, it's just ridiculous. You know what I mean? It's so hard not to like get a load and no, I don't advise that whatsoever. But when you open the top and smell it, it's amazing. So what I'll be doing with this is just literally just putting a few squirts on the pellets and just working them through. Because if everyone's using like the same pellets, obviously straight out of the bag, there's no sort of like, no umphing them pellets, you know what I mean? So this just gives them a little bit of an edge and, you know, I suppose it's a confidence thing. If you think it's something that's going to work, try it and it'll make you fish that a little bit better. But just by putting a little bit of a booster on them pellets, I'm sure it's going to make a difference. So we're going to be feeding 4 mils, not loads. I'm going to be tapping in 8 or 10 if you like, see what the response is. If I'm not getting a response, that's when I'll pick catapult up and start, you know, firing a bit of bait across there, so it's going to be going over a bigger area. And then hopefully that'll draw a few fish in. Down this middle, again, I'm feeding exactly the same sort of 8 to 10 4 mil pellets, but I'm going to be loose feeding there because I really want to attract them in. I will pop bait in when I fish it, but before that, I'm going to be loose feeding. I'll say about every 5 minutes, folks, but you know what I'm like for feeding. It's probably going to be every 1 or 2 minutes. So that's what we've got for feeding and for the band. And I've also just got some of our own 6 mil as hookers. You know, try different colour baits as well, folks. There's no right and wrong with it. You know, red pellets, green pellets, blue pellets, black, whatever. Whatever you've got confidence in, try it. A little bit of comb, whatever. But as a nice, simple, effective, easy way of fishing, just use the band and just use pellet, folks. It's so easy. So I think we should see if it's working. So without further ado, let's go and catch some fishies. I won't lie, folks. I've had a cheeky little go and the fishing is amazing. We've had a nice chunky mirror, probably like 2-2.5 pound. We've had the second bestest fish in the world, an id. We've had the joint third bestest fish in the world, a crucian. We've had like normal F1s and we've had ghosty F1s. I probably only fished for about 15 minutes, but I thought, because the kind of guy I am, I'd take a few minutes out just to show you before we actually go through the fishing process, banding the baits and how much bait we're feeding. Now, starting off with 4 mils, because 4 mils is going to give me the best chance of catching everything swimming. So, first things first, what I want to do is pick out sort of like, not the biggest 4 mil, but not the smallest 4 mil, but sort of like medium-sized 4 mil. So that's what we're doing first. Now, the next thing, now, I want you to get used to putting these on by hand, because obviously competition fishing, it's all about speed and time spent in the water. So if you're spending time after every time your bait comes off using a pellet bander, then it's just going to cost you time in the long run. By all means, for pleasure fishing, or if your hands are a bit shaky, that's what these are designed for. They're perfect. So I'll show you one of these first. Basically, we've got the little tiny Babby micro band on. You're putting the spikers all the way through and then you're just opening the band up. And then you're getting your pellet. It is a bit fiddly, it's just getting used to it, folks. That's all it is. All aspects of fishing, just getting used to it. That's why I like to put on like a slightly bigger pellet, just so it's easier in this respect. So you put your pellet right into the middle of it. I lost it then, folks. See, we even lose it. And then all we're doing, just grabbing the end of the band and then making sure that that band is smooth and in the middle of that pellet. So it wants to be smooth all the way around the pellet. So that's perfect. So nice and easy. But, as I said, we don't want to do that. I want to be putting them on by hand, so I'm going to use this same pellet. Now, you need to make sure you've got nails for the start. If you haven't got nails, just use a pellet bander. That's all I'm saying. So what I want to do is grab the band in my middle finger and my thumb, and then with the pellet in your middle finger and the thumb, present the band to the side of the pellet, and then with your index finger nail on the same hand that you're grabbing a pellet with, you want to put your nail right the way through that band and just loop it over the pellet, and that's it. Much quicker. Obviously, I'm a great advocate of changing your bait every fish, folks, but when there's loads there like there is today, you can catch, you know, multiples of fish on the same bait. It probably wouldn't make a blind bit of difference. It would for bigger fish, you know, where you're waiting a little bit longer for a bite, but certainly not for these smaller ones. Just if your bait's still on, just leave it. Make sure that that band is smooth all the way around the pellet, because sometimes the pellet can ping out, so we don't want that. So that's by hand. Next thing we'll go through is how much we're feeding. Now, bearing in mind, I've got my middle swim on the go, which I'm loose feeding. As I said before, I've got a pot on my rig, but I'm loose feeding it to attract the fish in. And that's getting like 10 to a dozen every 2 to 3 minutes. But on the swim across, I've not picked the catapult up yet. I've not had to. Literally, all we're putting in is sort of like, what's there, eight to ten pellets. Don't want to put loads in, because with what fish are there at the minute, there's a lot of stockies there. I don't want to get too much sort of like competition, if you like. You know, don't want too many fish in my peg. I just want to draw a few in. So by feeding more, I'm going to get more fish in my peg. I don't want that currently in the depth that I'm fishing. So 8 or 10 4mm pellets in there. And then what I'll do, I'll just give them a quick dink in the water. Now the beauty of our pots, the Preston pots, I've just got the smallest one on with a lid, is these little tiny perforations, the holes at the bottom, so you can completely dunk that pot under the water and then the water drains off through them. They're brilliant. And then what'll happen, your pellets will stay in, so when you're shipping across and then you're tipping that pole over and giving them a tap and all your pellets come out. And basically how it is in my hand there, there's a couple more left in that pot, but basically that's how they're going to sink down to the bottom. So if you can imagine your hook bait in that, fish are homing straight into it and they just like got so much confidence, they're just nailing your pellet and you're getting a bite very, very quickly. So that's the fishing process. That's all we're doing, folks. It's not complicated. So I reckon we need to go and catch some fishies. Yeah, boy, we can go and catch some fishies. I can't wait for it, folks. It's been so good. So pellets on, literally 8 or 10 in the pot. And what we're going to do is just give it a little bit of dink under the water, like I've just shown you. So that water's coming off. Now, what I like to do at this stage is prime middle swim as well. So 8 to 10 pellets there, feed some bait out. Now remember, folks, as I've gone through before, at the start of this, slight downward pressure on your pole. Don't look behind you, and we'll keep an eye on that rig. Now you see how low to the water that rig is, so it's not going to tangle. Yeah, just keep an eye on what that pot's doing. And then when you start to feel that pole start to tip over like that, lift it up and over your knees. Now my marker is, I've got a little yellow, I call it a buttercup, like I said before, but I don't think they are buttercups. And I've got like two dark branches going into the water. That's my marker. It's nice and flat over there. And I've got around, as well, I said, 2 foot, and I've found that depth. So first things first, when you're at this stage, just creep up to your marker. Now my other marker is the end of my pole on my back leg. Yeah, my back leg and my box, that's my marker. So what I'm going to do is twist my pot round and you'll see them pellets coming in the water there. We had a little dink then, actually. And then what I'm going to do is just drag my float over and into them pellets. You'll see also that the angle I've got on me, we had a little dink then, the angle I've got on my rig for my back shots. You either want, depending on which way the toe or wind's going, is a tight L or a tight J shape. Now also, you'll see how low I've dotted that float. When we start getting, I'd imagine it take a few minutes for the fish to come back, because I've been talking to you lovely lot. Incidentally, so you've seen how light I'm striking. It's so important. When I'm coaching anglers that have not necessarily fished at sort of this length before, and they get a bite, instinct is like, wah, give it a grab bigger. Now what happens when you're striking really hard, your pole comes down first and then goes up. So it has the reverse effect. You think you're being quick, you know, your pole's coming down first and then going up. So you see, them two little dinks I've had so far, I'm literally just lifting the pole up with my knee on me. I don't know what it is on my knee or my elbow, but you'll get used to that. Literally just a little tiny dink up and you'll be straight into the fish. Bearing in mind, there's a lot of stockies in here. That's why we're going to miss the odd bite. I have got a slope going away deeper to my left. That's why I'm laying it out that way. If you were fishing straight in front of you up to a slope, what you'd be doing is coming back, laying the rig in and then shoving the rig back up the slope. So every time it's going back against the ledge, nice and natural. Yeah, so just get used to that. So let's lay that in again. So I've got my pole and my mark on the back of my leg. I'm just going to hold a tight line to that float there. And I've got, you see, I've got them back shots just out of the water and I've tipex them out white so I can see them. And striking wise, little dinks. So all we want. The other thing as well to consider is the length of time you leave it before you feed again. Now I'm going to give it sort of 5 minutes. You know, for me, there's a lot of little stockies in here. They're going to eat that bait very, very quickly. Certainly bigger fish are going to nail it in one. So I want to make sure I'm keeping that bait going in. I've not felt the need to catapult any bait in yet to make loads of commotion because there's fish there. You see, it's just gone this little bit quieter now, probably because all them pellets have been eaten. But I'm going to wait a little bit longer. Not too much, before I'll come back and feed it again. Because I'm only feeding sort of 8 or 10 pellets, it doesn't take long for the bait to go. But it's just getting, you know, a few fish in your peg. I don't want loads there. See, that was a little dink then. I don't want loads of fish there. I just want to bring a few in. So you see then, we missed that bite and we're just going to lay that rig in again, down the ledge, so it's coming back into that shelf nice and natural. So things to, there's a little dink. So there you see what I mean about that little tiny dink. So it's just a little stocky F1, or it might be another crucian actually. You saw what I did, as soon as I hooked it, shit back nice and quick, get that fish out of your peg. Next thing is, look around, make sure the pole's on your roller. And then we're looking at the fish again, seeing what that's doing. Then when you get to your fourth section, again, look behind you, make sure you're on your back of your roller. But all the time, you see, I've got pressure on that fish. I don't want to let it go slack, and I want to make sure, oh, a little babby stocky. I want to make sure that obviously, when I'm shipping back, I'm keeping an eye on what that fish is doing. It's only two glances back. So once you've got one, ship back nice and quick, look for your roller, keep an eye on what that fish is doing, ship back, ship back, ship back. Number four section, look behind you, make sure you're on your roller, and then keep an eye on what that fish is doing. All right, it's a little babby one. Oh, but it's 10 out of 10, folks. Come on, Zolt, get in on that. 10 out of 10, that's what we're looking for. Right in that top lip, absolutely perfect. Right, so all about protecting your pole, folks, at this stage, and we would have gone through this in a margin one, but when you're fishing shallow, obviously the top gets a lot longer, I want to keep a little bit of tension on that rig. First things first, tuck the pole under your arm. None of this business, don't be putting it down because you're going to get a load of rubbish inside your top kit and potentially chip it, damage it, and we don't want that. So, tuck that top kit under your arm, come to the fish, unhook him, back in the landing net, and then safely returned. And then, obviously, we were saying before, because that pellet's still on, and there's a lot of little babby stockies there, I'm going to look straight in on that bait. I'm a massive advocate for changing bait, but obviously, you know, when there's a lot of little babby stockies there, you can get away with it. So, another 8 to 10 pellets in that pot, little dink. Just go through the same process again, folks. There's nothing complicated with what we're doing. 8 to 10 pellets out, feed that line there down the middle. Don't look behind you. Slight downward pressure on your pole. Starts to tip over, pick it up over your knees, and just take your time. Keep an eye on that pot all the time. So when you're coming onto that graphic section, your main section, your 30 meter section, just slow it down a bit, look behind you, I'm on my marker, tip that pot round, you'll see them pellets going in. There we go. Tiny little area, and just move your float over and into it. And when they're having it proper, see what I mean, you get little dinks like that straight away. So that could potentially be fish coming, you know, off the bottom to intercept them pellets on the drop. But I'd imagine you'd start, well, you would, you start foul looking them. Bumped a little fish then. If you are noticing you're missing loads of bites, you're foul looking them, then it's telling you that fish are coming straight into that bait. So all you do then is find shallower water. But even though it's bright today, that wind's blooming freezing. So that's why I want to stay in sort of 2 foot. Again, sort of later into the session, it might be that we'll have to move into shallower water. So you see, we've had three indications already. Maybe not necessarily proper bites, or that one was, but the whole sort of like essence of like, you know, little babby fish, if you like, it's just amazing. You're going to get bites, but you will miss them, you know, as they attack that bait. So again, just take your time, shipping back onto the fourth section, look behind me. Yeah, I'm on that roller, keep an eye on what that fish is doing. Nothing complicated with it at all, folks. Now, obviously, if you did want to try and target the bigger fish, all you'd end up doing, oh, he's a little babby one, look at him. Is that another 10 out of 10? It is, you know, it's another 10 out of 10. Give myself 10 out of 10 for that one. You on his old? He's sort of on it. 10 out of 10, folks, anyway. So if you did what I obviously target the bigger fish, that's for like later on in the session, you know, pellet's still on, folks. When you target the margins and this, that, and the other. But to start with, as I said, you know, with the commotion of everyone walking round, start off across, work your way back. That's why I've still got this, you know, I'm feeding this swim down the middle. So that if it, can't see it drying up over there, to be fair, but if it does, then that's when I'm going to drop down that middle, and then obviously later on in the session, I'm going to be feeding them margins. But different hook baits, that's why I've got obviously the 6 mils, but corn, bit of meat, whatever. Obviously check fishing rules on meat, because sometimes it's, you know, it's banned on a few waters, but anything like that. But for me, it's just all about, you know, when you're practicing it, you're going pleasure fishing, it's all about, there you go, that's how quick it can be sometimes. So he's taking it on the drop. It's all about just getting out and getting bites, folks, you know. This is the beauty of fishing, making sure you're coming back with a fish, and it's just amazing. I absolutely adore it. You know how much I love fishing, folks. It's just, how can you get fed up with this, you know? Obviously, we'd be able to catch these on the top kit, but for demonstrative purposes, I want to show you, obviously, fishing across, you know, at 13 metres, and you'll see we're not, I'm going to get another one on that pellet. We're not doing anything difficult. It's just making sure, because we're using shots, they ain't going to move, but making sure they're in the same position all the time. No slime on the rig. Now, obviously, them pellets that we fed there, they'll be on the bottom then. So I'd imagine a fairly quick response again this time. Because we had that one on the drop then, I'd imagine a very quick response. But it just shows how quickly you can build your peg. See, I'm not forgetting that swim there. My top kit and two on, we'll go to that in a bit. Again, nice and smooth. See, there's a carp here just under the surface, actually. So it's things like that to look out for. But at the minute, you never want to come off feeding fish. It's almost been like robotic-like, you know what I mean? Just keeping an eye on your markers. Wind's just blowing it a little bit then, so I'll move that pole a little bit lower. There we go. Lift that float up and in. Yeah, it's almost being robotic-like, making sure everything's in the same process. You're shipping out the same every time. Checking your markers here, checking the back of my poles on that leg. And that's why I don't need my little babby extension on for the back of that pole, because my elbow's not going onto it. My elbow is nicely down my pole, so it's not going to damage, the end. And I do like to use the markers that are, you know, the legs on my box. So accurate. Another little babby one. So there's a lot of little babby ones here at the minute. And obviously what we can do, I'm going to band a 6mm pellet, so we can get something a little bit bigger. Don't think we will, because obviously there's so many of these here. Oh, there's another 10 out of 10. Everyone's a 10 out of 10, folks. We are on it. And obviously that's telling you that you plumbed up absolutely, you know, bang on. Basically, on slopes, we're plumbing up to there, sort of halfway down the body. When down the middle, where it's a little bit softer, you want to be plumbing up to like the bottom of the body to allow for like the silt and everything. You're on that result? Yeah, so hard ground, slopes, middle, soft ground, silt, bottom, or even a little bit further down, depending on wind, undertone, things like that. Right, I said I was going to change that. I'm going to put a 6mm on. I'm either going to miss loads of bites or hopefully get something a little bit bigger. Because we're slightly, as I say, on that curve, if you like, over depth, we shouldn't have to take a shot off. Obviously, a bigger pellet, it's just going to, you know, potentially take that float down a little bit, but we should be all right. You see, I'm not doing anything difficult every time. It's all about getting used to it to start with, but make sure you don't strike too hard. I can't stress that enough, folks. It's all about that striking. So, pellets in, bring your float into it, and then we're just waiting, because you're setting that trap. 6mm on, hopefully we'll get something a bit bigger. We have had a mirror about two and a half, but everything else has been sort of like them little stockies. But again, that's the beauty of it, especially when you want to, you know, practice something that you've not done before. You want to make sure that you're going on a venue where you're going to get bites. You don't just want to be sitting there waiting and waiting and waiting. And that's the beauty of it here at Aston Park. It's full of fish. So that was a bigger fish over there then. So a little bit longer for a bite, but hopefully it might be a little bit bigger. Might not be, but hopefully it will be. Just trying a 6mm pellet. But as I said, for 5 minutes, don't let 5 minutes go by without feeding. And if you weren't getting bites, obviously it's not been a problem for us yet. We've been getting bites every time we're going in. If you weren't, to make commotion, that's when you, whoa, I bumped one there, but it was only a little babby one. What I'd do probably in a match situation, because I bumped one, I'd come back, check the bait and probably feed it again, but we don't need to bother for that for today, folks. What was I waffling about before? If you weren't getting bites, that's when you pick catapult up and start pinging. In fact, I'm going to ping a few just so I can show you what I mean, because of that commotion. Yeah, you see how they're going over sort of like a bigger area, but it's that noise. It sometimes instantly draws fish in, but you've got to be very, very careful with how often you feed it, because you can get fish all over the place and blow your peg very, very quick. So that's why at the minute there's no need to use the catapult, just use your pot. Yeah, draw fish in into that little zone where you're fishing. And that's what it's all about. So you can see the difference by using a more selective bait. You know, a 6mm, it's just taking that little bit longer to get a bite. Which, you know, by all means, it'd be fine. But if it was a bit of a fish race in the competition, I'd want to be keeping up. So obviously I'd stick to the 4mm. Bigger baits for me are sort of like later on to the session, when you really want to target them sort of bigger fish. They've definitely not gone. It's just the fact that we've got a bigger bait on. Put a few more pellets in down that middle. I'm lined up with my marker still, them two little branches coming into the water, back of my poles on my back of my leg. But for me, there's no, as I said, there's no bigger fish there to pick out that 6mm pellet. It's mad, isn't it, the difference. We'll still wait a bit. See, there's something in my peg now. Just see that float move. Incidentally, I'm a massive one for lifting and dropping. That was another little babby one. So we'll go back to a 4mm, but I just wanted to show you the difference, yeah? Putting a slightly more selective bait on, you'd think there's no fish in your peg. There is, it's just the fact that them little babby ones probably can't get that pellet in the mouth. But if there was a bigger fish there, it would have nailed it. So we'll go back onto a 4mm. And as I said, them sixes are something that we'd go to later on. Get a bit more bait in. We did bump a couple on that bait then. Some fours in. So I think I'll catch one more over there and we'll have a do down the middle. I've not even tried it down the middle yet, but they have been blowing. There's another bubble coming up there. I'd imagine there'd be little babby stockies again, but you never know. Never know. Again, as you're shipping out, slight downward pressure. Keep an eye on what that rig's doing, that pot. When it starts to tip over, lift it off your roller. Over above your knees, nice and smooth. Keep an eye on that pot. A little bit far then. Back of your pole on that leg. Twist it over and then put your pellets in. There we go. So we should get a bite a lot quicker now because we're on a smaller bait. And obviously with being smaller fish, it should go a little bit quicker. If it doesn't, and that tells me, you know, there might be a bigger fish moving in, or I do need to start pinging a little bit of bait. There we go, a little dink then. So I just struck a little bit hard then because I got a bit giddy, and it just shows you the difference with, you know, almost like a delayed reaction. What you want to do is lift up like that. See what I mean? We hooked it then. It'd have been exactly the same fish and the same kind of bite, but the fact that I sort of lifted rather than struck was straight into that fish. Beautiful fishing. It just shows the difference, doesn't it, with the baits. Having the wrong bait on at the wrong time. You know what I mean? So, that's the last fish we're going to catch over there. Little babby stocky. What I'm going to do now is come down the middle. Oh, it's another 9 out of 10, that one, folks. 9 out of 10. What I'm going to do now is come down the middle and have a do there. Now, because I've been feeding it for probably an hour, getting on for an hour or something, I'm fully expecting to get a bite very quick, simply because of how it's been over there. And the fact that I've rested it, I can see there's like bubbles coming up, so I know there's fish there. If I don't get a bite within 5 minutes, I'm coming off it. It's pointless. I mean, obviously, match conditions, I'm talking about pleasure fishing now, match conditions, you never ever come off feeding fish. Not unless you see someone on the short line catching the same fish as what you are across there. It's going to be twice as quick catching them shorter. You know what I mean? So I just want to try it. If we don't get one within 5 minutes, you're coming off it. Keep the bait going in, because at some point in the day they will arrive. Same with your margins. And then we go back across there because we know there's fish there. So first thing you want to do, make sure you unship your pole first. I forget this all the time, folks. So I like ship out. I'm like, blooming heck, I'm only fishing short. And then you go to unship your pole and like your bait's gone everywhere. So make sure you unship your pole first. So now what I've done, I've put me three sections of pole on the other side of my roller, and the three sections that I'm using, they're on this side of the roller closest to me. Nice and simple. So let's pick out, I want to say a deep rig, but it's not that much deeper, to be fair.
That'd be fair.
It's only like 3.5 foot. Let's get a 4mm. I'm going to start with a 4mm on, because that's what we've been loose feeding. Now, feeding wise now, although I've been loose feeding around every 5 minutes, but it's not been, folks, it's been like every 2 minutes, because you know what I'm like. I'm going to stop that and feed through a pot. I've not got a sprinkle lid on this one this time, because I just want to get that bait straight in. Only the same amount, 8 or 10, and I'm still going to dink them under the water. Yeah, but I want to get them straight in. So you're shipping your pole out a little bit different this time, folks, in that I like to ship it out over my knee, and I will pick it off the roller. So if you want to, you can look behind you. As soon as that pole comes right to the end of the roller, just pick it off and then just make sure it's keeping it nice and low, and take your time when you're shipping out. Now, we're only fishing short. What I'm using, I'm going to pull that landing net down, actually. I'm using the joint where my 4 and 5 meet. I'm lining that up with my front leg, so I know I'm going back to the same spot every time. And then I've got a tree opposite me, or slightly to the right, that I'm lining up with, yeah? So, very important that we're fishing accurate. So, joint on that leg. Twist that pot round, and then pellets going straight away. And then what I'm going to do, I'm just going to follow the wind. On some venues you'll go to, certainly like more open water lakes, where there's a pronounced slope, What you'd be doing there is flicking that rig out away from you, so it's coming back down nice and natural onto the ledge. But on snake lakes, or you know, you're fishing on flat bottom, just whichever way the wind's going, just lay it in that way. So the wind's going right to left, I'm going to lay it in that way, come back to my marker, and then hold a tight line to my float with me back shot. So it's on that tree. So we should have a little dink then, which I'd fully expect because we've been priming it for so long, and then we're just waiting. Slightly heavier float on this time, remember, 4/12, just so it's in, you know, showing them bites up. Without that bristle, see, we had a little dink then. Without that bristle, I'd probably want to dot that down a little bit more. I'd probably have a number 12 or even 11 on that. See, that was a little dink then. So there is signs of fish there. And again, striking wise, because we're on a bare hook, you don't need to strike hard, literally, that's it. So it's nice and quick. We had that little dink then. What we're looking for, anything slower to the side, ignore. We're waiting for it to go nice and quick. Won't necessarily always take your float under, but it's just that nice and quick. That's what we're looking for. See, another little bubble come up there, a foot away. So we know there's fish there. Now, what I will do when I'm on flat bottom is lift and drop. Them little tiny movements will attract the fish. See, we had a little dink then. Again, tiny strike, straight back down to him. And again, you know, if we're not getting another little dink then, I don't know what these, they might even be goujons or something, folks. I don't know, I'd imagine there'd be little stockies. There's definitely fish there. And obviously, again, if we're not getting signs to draw fish in, loose feed. But to start with, I want to, you know, see what's there through the pot, because I have been loose feeding, and there would be in a bigger area, I want to use the pot to, like, really zone the fish into where I'm fishing, if that makes sense. Fishing to where I'm fishing, you know what I mean. I'm fishing there, I want to feed there. So the fish like really home in on it. That float, I do apologise, it's a bit like a lighthouse. I don't need another. Right, so you see how fast that bite was there. I'm going to come and sort that blooming rig up, because that's too, that float's too high. I'm going to put a number 11 under that float, just to like really dot it down. And I'll show you what I mean. Like that was a very fast bite, but because it was quick, 100% it was a proper bite. It wasn't a liner. I know I say I don't miss proper bites, liners, but that was a proper bite, I can't get away with that. So I'll put a little stop underneath the float, just to bring that float down, and then we'll go in again. I'm happy that there's fish there, so I'm going to stay on that line. Another 8 or 10 pellets. Give it a little dink in the water, little dinky-doo! And then take your time with shipping out, pick that pole off your roller, nice and low, line up. So marker on that, jump your pole on that, on the tree, tippy tippy tap tap, and just lift that pole or rig out and just lay it in, whichever way the wind's going. Right, come on, we'll catch one this time. I'm fishing right. There we go, see how much, there you go. See what I mean about just jotting that float down that little bit more? And obviously it's coming to, probably them pellets you were putting before, it might be an id dish, you know. Might be an id. Go on, the ids. Is it? Go on. Is it? It blooming is, you know. One of the second bestest fish in the whole wide world, folks. And that's generally what you can expect. He's nailed it as well. Look at that, beautiful lids. Second bestest fish in the whole wide world. You know what number one is. I need to get the scourger out, don't I? Thought I got one out. In fact, actually, disgorges wise, we don't cover this enough. When you're using a disgorger, it's so important. I see people do this wrong all the time. You see, I wouldn't advocate sitting on your pole, but obviously I know exactly what angle to sit on it. So let's get that under the arm. Let's get that under the arm to start with. Now, what you want to make sure when you're using the disgorger is that you've got tension on your line. It's the most important thing in the world. Now, obviously the groove in the disgorger goes on the line, and with these fingers, so you see, like, not my middle finger, the one behind it, and then my little finger, I'm tensioning the line up even more. So I'm putting the disgorger into the mouth, feel the resistance of the hook, light push, and there you go, straight into it. And it's so easy, but I see a lot of anglers, you know, complicating it when using disgorger. Dead simple. Now, also, fish like that, like they do like to obviously feed shallow, and they will sort of like come into that noise. That's probably why there's eyed there, because I have been loose feeding there, making more noise. A great way of catching, obviously, the silvers, the eyed, chub, things like that, would be to use maggots. But for like a lovely cheap day's fishing, a bag of pellets, folks, you catch pretty much everything swimming. there's not many fish that are going to turn down the pellet, if any. You know what I mean? Obviously, if you were targeting eyed only, then I would recommend going down the maggot route. But, you know, just nice, lovely, cheap days fishing, get on the pellets. That's all you need. So we'll try that again. So line that pole up on the tree, put your bait in, rig out, hold a tight line over your bait. Now, because we've come off that line over there, rather than use a catapult, what I'd be doing is nipping across with a pot and just tapping in sort of like 20 pellets every 10 or 15 minutes, something like that. Just to keep a few fish in the peg and, you know, letting the fish know that there's going to be bait there, so that when you go in, you know, the fish are nice and confident and you're straight back into the fish. But having said that, I probably wouldn't have come off them fish over there without it was. You know, I'd still be on them. So you see how much, whoa, I had a little dink there. I struck a bit hard. But again, it just shows you, doesn't it? You get a little bit giddy and you strike too hard. You don't need to strike hard. I'll do a proper strike on this next one. But you can see how much lower that float's sitting, which is perfect. That's what we want. What you want in this water here, see what I mean? A little tiny dink and away you go. Now what you can do, if you get a fish that swims back through, you know, your bait, just pick a few loose offerings up, throw them in, just to get them fish back in the area. Because when you've got a pot on, you know what I mean, they're coming right to where you're fishing. Is it a crewy? Is it a crewy? Go on, be a crewy. Ah, oh, it's a little F1. It's a little F1, but it's same, you know, same as what we're catching over there. Don't look at the hook hold. I'm going to give yourself 5 out of 10 for that one. Probably a bit slow at the strike, to be fair. Yeah, you can see how you can achieve, you know, different lines, if you like. So you can rest a swim, go into another one, carry on catching fish. Then obviously, later on in the session, that's when the margins will come into play. Not covering it today, but margins come into play, obviously, when the weather warms up even more, they're so important, but so is that depth of water across there. It's two areas of your peg that you just can't overlook, but this is why you need that extra length, cheeky, with your pole to get to where the fish are across. And as I said, with it coming bright, you see the shade we've got over there, you've got to get to that cover. You know, we're getting bites down the middle, but it's not as many as we're getting across. So it just goes to prove that, you know, obviously, fishing across whilst you're priming the middle swim is so important, folks. I think that's pretty much all there is to it. I mean, I'm going to carry on catching fish, obviously, because fishing is the bestest thing in the whole wide world. But yeah, I hope you've enjoyed it and you've got something from it. You know, there's nothing complicated with it. All you've got to do is just go out and practice, practice, practice. Remember the striking, don't strike too hard. Just take your time when you're shipping out, just be nice and smooth. And take your time with the feed as well. I'm not the best advocate for it, folks. I do appreciate that, but I've been restrictive on myself today. I've not put loads in. But yeah, get yourself to a venue with a load of fish in, such as Aston Park, where you're guaranteed bites and you just have a great session. And that's what it's all about, just getting out there and enjoying it. So give it a go, folks. Get longer pole, get to that far bank and just enjoy your fishing. Yeah.